Is from Denmark.
Yeah.
If I right understand, you are from Larsen.
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. So,
thank you.
Is the Moulding green sign photos for everyone? Moulding for everyone.
Thank you very much. I have prepared a small agenda for today. First, a small introduction, then a list of pains for small and mid-sized foundries, then how we see a solution for these pains, and then how we try to address these pains, and then a conclusion on this setup. So, first a few words about the background. So I believe all of you are used to be in foundries, so you will know all these challenges by heart. So I'm sure you face challenges with increasing efficiency. You face challenges with enhancing productivity. You also face challenges with a need for improving casting quality. And I'm also sure that you, what happens? You face challenges with need for increasing in savings or cutting costs. At the same time, you also have to battle concerns with working conditions and with the environmental load. So these challenges and concerns, they are valid for all foundries, independent of size, where are you situated in the world, and what market are you acting in. Over the years, main focus has been on high-end foundries. You can get all the high-speed molding lines you want. You can get a lot of nice robotic solutions supporting you if you do long series in your foundry. But the challenges we see here on the top and the concerns, they are also valid for small foundries and mid-sized foundries. Like we see here, an example of a George Squeeze foundry with, of course, a smaller capacity than these high-speed foundries. So we really need some solutions addressing the challenges met in this type of foundry, because over the years, most focus has been on these high-end foundries. So what we need are solutions that aim at foundries with lower production capacities and also lower investment capacities. So the task has been to make a modern state-of-the-art equipment available for small and mid-sized foundries all over the world. So what is different for these small and mid-sized foundries? Yeah, first of all, they are small and mid-sized, meaning they produce fewer tons than we normally focus at. But then they also have some additional pains we wanted to address. One of them is lack of labor. And yeah, I'm sure some of you know it. But even though we are looking at these so-called growth areas, it is very often difficult to find labor. We have tried to symbolize that with this bus. Are you looking at an area in India like Coimbatore, where you have a lot of foundries? It's actually quite difficult to find labor, even though you have so many people living in India. So we have to transport people maybe 2,000 kilometers by bus to get enough labor in these areas. Second key pain is lack of funding. So in these smaller and mid-sized foundries, it's a little more difficult to find money to invest in equipment. Then we have the third pain, lack of consistency in casting quality. And if you go to these foundries, and if you go to the fettling area, you will see a lot of people working in the fettling area. And that is actually due to the fact that part of the geometry is generated in the fettling area. In some cases, more geometry is generated in the felling area than in the moulding area. And that is due to use of either semi-automatic or manual processes in the casting production, meaning you are highly depending on your skilled or your skills of your labors. Then the fifth or fourth key pain, that is a need for a high degree of flexibility. When you look on these foundries, they actually produce many types of castings, not only simple types of castings. Here we have an example of a quite complicated impeller wheel for a pump. So we also need some flexibility. Then the last pain, I don't want to show any pictures right now of that, but I believe most of you have been in these foundries, and you will see that, yeah, I think I will not offend too many people if I say that that working environment is often a challenge. So, based on these five key pains, a new solution has been developed, building on more than 50 years of experience with developing green sand molding equipment. So, the solution is based on this very simple and robust vertical molding principle. So, basically, we have two linear movements in the machine, quite simple. And we have six operations. First operation is the sand shot. We fill the sand into the chamber. Second operation is squeezing. Third operation is we open the chamber. Fourth operation is we push out the mold and make a mold close up and transport. Fifth operation is that we move the first pattern plate back into the chamber. And then the sixth operation is that we close the chamber again, and then we are ready for the next cycle. So shoot, we squeeze, we open the chamber, we push out the mold, we make mold transport, we return the first pattern plate into the chamber, and we close the chamber, and then we are ready for the next cycle. So a very, very simple operation, and it's actually done by two linear movements of the machine. Because we are acting in this this segment with very small foundries, we have now three possibilities available. One addressing the segment of around 3,000 tons per year. Another one addressing around 5,000 tons per year. And a third one addressing around 8,000 tons per year. I emphasize around because, of course, it depends on are you running two or three shifts per day? How many kilos do you pour per mold? Is it very thin, light castings you produce? Or is it heavy castings you produce? But these options here address tonnages in this segment. So quite different from what we are used to when we talk about this molding technology. It comes in two different sizes, which are the normal sizes. We can call them de facto standards, so you're actually also able to use pattern plates one and other foundries with this setup. So, with this solution, how do we then address these key pains? Let's try to have a look in detail. Lack of labor. I don't know if it's possible to see here, but you will see a lot of yellow hard hats in this foundry, producing not so many molds per hour. You will also see a lot of people here in this fiddling area. But if we change into this new technology, then you reduce the number of labors for molding from maybe 10 to 20 people. So in rough numbers, there's a factor 10 in the molding area. Again, it's a rough number, of course it depends on is it cored, uncored castings, etc. But as a rough figure, you can say that, okay, you go from maybe 10 to 20 people per shift to maybe 1 to 2 people per shift. So a huge decrease in number of manpower. You will also see a decrease of manpower in the fettling shop because now we are talking about automated molding. So you will get a more consistent quality. Lack of funding. Okay, if we are comparing to manual molding, then it's difficult to compete with investment. But if you compare to conventional equipment, then we are talking about an investment only 1/3 of what is normally seen. Lack of consistency in casting quality. Maybe this video is a little dark, but here you see some manual molding is being made. Here you see some semi-automatic molding, but still with a huge degree of manual interface. So you are highly depending on your workforce. With this new setup, core setting can be done automatic. Molding is also done automatic, so you will only to a very low degree be depending on your manpower or the skills of your manpower. And that will of course have a positive influence on the consistency in casting quality. Need for high degree of flexibility. These foundries, they have to be flexible in many different directions. Today I can mention two different dimensions. One is regarding core setting. So with this device, core setting can be done automatic. It can also be done manual if you're running a shorter series, if you have a very complicated course, if you have some course where you need to do some manual changes before you can close the mold like here, then you can do that also. It's also flexible with regards to tooling. You can reuse tools from other lines, or here you can use an adapter solution, which will keep the cost for tooling at an absolute minimum. So this device or this setup will give you a high degree of flexibility in many different dimensions. Then we have the last pain. How do we address that? Another video from a George Squeeze foundry. I can assure you, if you have been working here 8-10 hours per day, you will sleep very good in the night, because that is very hard work to be here. Also in the shakeout area is quite hard work. How do we address that? In this case, we have a small animation showing how it looks if you produce cord castings with manual core setting. So the operator has to place the cores in a nice working environment, and then he just has to restart the machine. If it's on-cord production, then the job for this operator will be more like a supervisor. So that's how we address these five different pains. And if we try to conclude on that, then we can see that we have addressed lack of labor. We can reduce the need for labor for the molding area with up to a factor 10. We can reduce the need for resources to maybe 1/3, depending on the setup you need, but it's in this magnitude, to 1/3 of what is normally seen. We can also address the lack of consistency in casting quality, as we now have automated molding, meaning you are no longer to this very high extent depending on the skills of your labor force. We can address flexibility in many different dimensions. Today I just mentioned the core setting and patterns, but of course there are a number of other dimensions also. Need for better working environment, I think the video showed that very clear. And this is done by a very simple and straightforward working principle with these two linear movements. We have some robust solutions making it possible to operate and maintain the equipment with generally skilled people in a safe working environment. And then we also have both capacity and investment suitable for these small and mid-sized foundries. And then it's also coming with some on-site local support. So I think with this, I can, as a concluding remark, say that now modern green sand molding for everyone is available. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. For- for your presentation. Automatic DISA lines are a well-known solution for every kind of foundry shops, but I hope that we will have some particular questions for our guest. Yes. No, because I saw the hand up. No.
Yeah, maybe I have one more comment for some of the presentations. Yesterday, there were some comments about this was presented, but is it really true this? So we can say that this is not just something we dream about. This is true. We have already a high number of these lines running in China and India, and now we also will get some here in Europe. So we are not just dreaming about a solution here. This is really the truth we are showing here.
Thank you. Okay, no questions. So once again, thank you for your presentation.
Green Sand Foundry of Tomorrow. It could actually have had a subtitle stating Does Green Sand Moulding Have a Future? Some will maybe claim no, some will claim yes, but
yes.
I will try to thank you. I'll try to say some words about the future of green sand moulding. Again, I prepared an agenda for today, an introduction, some examples. It's quite a short presentation, this 15 minutes, so it's difficult to give a full view on the future of green sand moulding. So I have tried to pick some interesting examples of how we see green sand moulding will move into the future. So these today are only examples, and the examples will address sustainability, Industry 4.0, and productivity. And then I will try to conclude on the outlook for green sand moulding. So first, a short introduction. Basic clay-bound moulding has been around for many, many, many years. And the clay-bound sand molds we know today and which is used industrially today, we also know for quite some years. But even though it's a very old technology, many thousands of years old, still we have a huge potential for development. If we look a little bit on the history, then there has been a huge focus on productivity. But today we are looking in many other dimensions when we talk about the future for green sand moulding technology. And as I already stated, some of the areas that I will mention today with some examples, and we will try to focus on hands-on examples. We, of course, also have some visions looking 5 years into the future or even more. But it's the solutions that we can use tomorrow or the day after tomorrow or maybe next year that will take us into the future. So I will try today to focus a little bit on some hands-on examples. Sustainability. I believe everybody agrees that sustainability is super important, and that for sure will be part of the future. It comes in many different forms and shapes. I have brought a couple of examples today addressing sustainability. One is less strain on the operators. When we talk about green sand molding, we also very often talk about automotive components, meaning parts produced in huge, huge numbers. And when we talk about parts produced in huge numbers, it also means that the operators have to do the same movements over and over again. So one example is setting cores in uncored molds. Until recently, the operator had to do the same movement 400 to 500 times per hour, maybe 8 hours or 10 hours per day. And clearly that would put a lot of strain on your shoulders and on your arms, and it would be more and more difficult to allow people doing the same movement so many times per hour. Now we have some new innovations, maybe it's not rocket science, a small super fast robot working together with a molding machine with a very aggressive overlap. You will see the robot arm here, and this is the movable part of the machine, and I can promise you if they don't agree on who will be at what position to which time, then the robot will lose this battle. Here normally you would have an operator putting the filters into the core mask 400 to 500 times per hour. Now you have an empty space and a device loading the filters to the robot. And instead of the fingers of the operator, we have a small gripper of the robot doing the job. So, another example of sustainability is the use of materials and energy. Of course, in the future and also right now, we have to focus on not spending so much or so many materials and so much energy. One example is the pouring cup. A typical gating layout with the pouring cup with a number of kilos of iron in. This iron will solidify and then we have to return it to the scrapyard and remelt it. So that is a clear waste of energy and materials. With a new type of system, we can introduce we can call it a pouring basin instead of a pouring cup. And then it's possible to pour the metal into this pouring basin very fast, maybe 8 kilos per second or even more. Then we fill the pouring basin and then we can drain this basin slowly with a slow filling rate inside the mold cavity, maybe 4 kilos per second. Then we drain this pouring basin to a very low level, meaning we have clearly less metal left here than in the original pouring cup. If we see the mold string from top, we will see this basin instead of the normal pouring cup. How does it look in real life? We fill the pouring basin and then we can see the metal drains down. If we try to look at an example from a Spanish foundry running this, we introduced it on 6 different pattern plates, and in average we saved 1.4 kilo of iron per mold. A typical foundry in this category will produce maybe 1 million molds per year, so with this setup we can save 1.4 million kilo of liquid iron per year. That is, of course, quite a lot of energy, and of course also quite a lot of CO2 we can save here. Some will claim that you need some extra mold height to be able to drain this basin. That's of course true. You need the ferrostatic pressure to do the last part of the filling, and if you don't have enough mold height, you will not fill the mold. But with such a large gain here, it will still be interesting if you cannot use it on all your pattern plates. Maybe you can only use it on 1/3 of your pattern plates, but still that will be around 500,000 kilos of liquid metal you can save per year. So one way to save the earth from a lot of CO2. Another way or possibility to reduce the use of materials and energy is reducing the scrap and rework due to geometrical issues, basically meaning a mismatch. So today technology is available, make it possible to do a real-time scanning of the molds where we can measure mismatch, parallelism, steps and mold gaps quite precise, I can say. And how is this done? We have a reference mark in the upper corner of the molds and some precision lasers, and they can then measure different values describing these four parameters. So we have a simple but yet very important reference geometry in each of the four corners of the molds. We can see a typical pattern plate here for a brake disc, and here we have a picture of this rather simple but important reference geometry. And this geometry combined with the laser measurements is the reason why we can measure these parameters. This is done directly before we pour the molds. So this means we have these values available before we pour the molds, meaning if we find that we have a mold gap at the bottom of the mold, maybe we have dropped a core, maybe we have dropped a filter, and due to the high speed of the molding line, nobody realizes that we have a dropped filter and a mold gap in the bottom. But with this system, it can be detected that we have a mold gap, meaning we can prevent pouring a mold where we will have a mold run through, for instance. So on the video, we can directly follow the mismatch of the molds and we can react before we start to pour out of tolerance molds. And this of course means that we can reduce scrap and also rework. If we know that we always pour perfect molds, then we can clearly also reduce the need for rework. Industry 4.0, I think I will not say too much about that today, because there has been a lot of very interesting presentations on that. Just a couple of words from our point. So again, there are many different aspects of 4.0. In our mind, the first step is data availability. Today, when you do troubleshooting, for instance, look for sand inclusions, porosities, metal penetration, etc., you normally have to look into different databases. The sand plant has a database, the molding line has a database, the pouring device has a database. So it's quite difficult to do troubleshooting because you do not have data available in one system. So we have this unstructured data today, and first step is to have structured data, meaning you have access to all data in one system. One example is this cockpit system, where you will get access to data from all different kinds of the foundry in one system. Meaning if you have to do troubleshooting, for instance, try to troubleshoot sand inclusions. You know, yesterday at 7 o'clock I had sand inclusions. Why? Then you can look at such a nice dashboard. Say, okay, what happened at 7 o'clock yesterday? This parameter changed. And this parameter changed, that you can have at one glance instead of looking into maybe five or six different systems. So the troubleshooting will be much more efficient, and clearly when you have data available, it will open up for a lot of more opportunities with automatic systems supporting you. So you don't need the very, very skilled operators making all the decisions. Productivity, yeah, I think still productivity is very, very important. We will never get around productivity, so we should not forget that. We have these high-speed molding lines. In the earlier presentation I showed, I think it's wrong to call it slow-speed molding lines, but it is possible to get some very fast molding lines up to 555 molds per hour. But there are a number of bottlenecks today stopping foundries from using this high capacity. Again, coming back to this example with setting of filters, it has actually two benefits. We can remove this operator so he will not destroy his shoulders and arms doing the same movement again and again. But at the same time, we can actually also speed up the line with 70 molds per hour. So it's not only the foundry that has to think about the workers when they invest in this, they will actually also get a strong gain on productivity. We also normally have some bottlenecks regarding mold filling because the machines are so fast. This fast pour system I showed earlier, or what we call double index, where we pour two molds at the same time, can also support speeding up productivity. So with these systems, we can gain more than 20% extra productivity than otherwise seen. Again, this inline monitoring of different parameters may not speed up the line, but as it will reduce scrap, it will at the end of the day increase productivity. So, a small conclusion. I believe we can say that clay-bound sand molding technology still has a great potential for further development. Today we have highlighted a couple of examples addressing sustainability, Industry 4.0, and also productivity. But these are only some examples. There are many different other dimensions we can develop green sand molding in. Just one extra example, that's feeding. Also new techniques is available on feeding. So really we have a huge number of parameters where we can develop the green sand technology. And this leads to my concluding remark. A positive outlook for the Green Sand Foundry is seen. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for the second perfect presentation today. And do we have any questions? I would like to ask you, because you are a specialist of DISA. This automatic line is a perfect situation because it's a complete system. As you said, that in foundry shops we have data in many places, laboratories, quality points and other different places that we haven't one database where we gathered all data. This automatic line is a quite different situation. It's a perfect place to for some solution where we can predict using, for example, soft modeling or something like that. Could you say something about? Because I know that during normal cycle in DISA-matic we check the parameters of the green sand, like a strength or compactability or other things, yes? But can we predict something in advance before the next mold comes to the pouring place or not? Or thank you.
How to answer that? I think really this line is the key. So when we have data available, first step is we can have some operators doing some things, addressing, okay, I have a parameter going up, I have to do something. The next step is I can automate this process, I can get a computer to make this decision. And when we have data available, next step is to predict, instead of be proactive, then to predict. So I totally agree with you, and I strongly believe that really data availability, once you have the data available, then you have these possibilities also to predict what will happen, because we are living in a world, it's not God that decides what will happen, it's the data. If you have sand moisture going up, then you will have a number of parameters that will change. So I totally agree with you, predicting will be also part of the future.
Because previous presentation, we can show that strength or other parameters of the green sands change after many thermal cycles, for example. But also the size and shape of the sand grains also change during this. And we have in this automatic we have a million times.
Yeah,
mixing and moisturing and stressing and so on. So we think about we want to predict the changes in diameter of the mold and also the change of the parameter of the pattern, because the change diameters change, slow down and so on. So
We totally agree. We need to predict instead of measure and then realize you did something wrong. That's also what we start or try to do with this system, if I can go back. This one, we try to maybe not predict, but before we pour, we get a number saying, are we going to produce scrap or are we going to produce good castings? Because I'm sure in the future, nobody can afford to produce scrap. So we need to predict. This is maybe a bad example, could be a bad example. But in the future, we need to predict to avoid producing scrap. And once we have data in this system, then we have these opportunities.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yes, please.
I might have a question that kind of is a follow-up to the previous one that the professor asked. Once you have the data, and do you think that you could possibly make a system that would not only automatically store the data, but also process them and perhaps improve the process on its own?
So autonomous system improving the process. Yeah, when you have data available, then really. Yeah, only the sky is the limit, but key is to have data available, because that's really what we see in many foundries. When we go into foundries, previous I was working in our application department, meaning I went around the world trying to do troubleshooting in these magic foundries. Then we had to look in 5 or 6 different databases to find the data that we need to troubleshoot some simple parameters like sand inclusions. There can be a number of reasons for sand inclusions, and normally you have to go around and look in a number of different databases to find the answer. So yes, in the future you can for sure imagine such systems. No question about that.
That would be a really nice solution. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there some questions more? No? Okay, so I would like to say thank you for
your.